HarperCollins and Harper Audio present So-Called Normal, a memoir of family, depression, and resilience by Mark Henick. Read by Sean Patrick Hopkins. Author's note. This story is my truth. Don't take that to mean that it's anyone else's truth. I want to be upfront with you about that. That's the whole point of this project, after all. This is my side, my interpretation, my story. On historical facts, dates, places, and the like, I tried my best to get them right and to check them as much as possible. I spent hours on research, combing through records and mining other people's memories. Many of the words or conclusions of doctors, social workers, nurses, and other healthcare providers are quoted or paraphrased from their session notes, which I obtained through the disclosure of my medical records. I also drew information from police and school records. I wove this information in and stitched it together in the way that I felt worked best for my story. I have intentionally changed some people's names and descriptions where that information is not relevant to retelling my story to protect their identity. I have also reorganized the details of a small number of events, specifically when they occurred, for the sake of clarity and flow. Some details have almost certainly been unintentionally missed or edited out to abridge the story. It is also worth noting that I discovered numerous conflicting reports and easily verifiable factual errors throughout these documents, depending on which professional was writing the notes. This validated for me how fragmented my care and the mental health system more broadly really was. You should also be aware that this book will contain triggers for some people. It has descriptions of suicide, including ideations and attempts that I've personally experienced. It also contains descriptions of self-harm, alcohol and drug misuse, bullying and harassment, emotional and sexual abuse, chemical and mechanical psychiatric restraint, domestic violence and police interaction, among other potentially triggering elements. These stories are in here because they happened to me. I've tried to present them realistically, honestly, and as part of the much broader and more detailed context of my life. Part of this journey for me is about learning and respecting people's limits. Discomfort is a healthy, even necessary part of growth. Re-traumatizing or vicariously traumatizing yourself is not. If you're not sure how you will react, or if you thought you'd be okay but find yourself passing from discomfort into distress, turn the book off. Engage or discover your self-care and coping routines and reach out for help. Do not struggle in silence. I'm not a doctor. The treatments and interventions that you'll hear me talk about, which may or may not have worked for me, may or may not work for you. We may have a lot in common, but your story and your recovery journey are as unique to you as mine are to me. Something that was a disaster for me might end up being the thing that finally works for you. Your journey is yours. I probably don't know you, but there's a good chance we have had some shared challenges. I've made it through, at least so far, and for as far as I can see into the future. So will you. We didn't come this far to only come this far. If it feels like too much now, trust me, this too shall pass. At the very least, over time, you will learn to struggle well. Years from now, when you least expect it, you may even start to see the gifts that your perseverance left you. Sometimes you don't realize how far you've come until you look back. That's what writing this book taught me. Mark. If you are silent about your pain, they'll kill you and say you enjoyed it. Zora Neale Hurston. Prologue. This is the end. I'm sure of it. At least, I think I'm sure. I don't want to die. It's just that dying is sort of a non-negotiable part of killing yourself. I have no choice. It feels like nobody can help me, however much they tried or tried to try. I tried too, for a while. I can't anymore. I can't live like this. It's nearly midnight. My socks are in my pocket. My feet are cold and naked in my shoes. My heels balance on the chipped concrete edge while my toes hang out over nothing. I shift my footing, and a team of tiny pebbles spills from the side of the bridge. I look down. I watch the pebbles fall as far as I can see them, from my hand-me-down runners to the scraggy ground below. It's probably far enough to do the job, if I can stick the landing as I have visualized so many times. It might be 20 feet down, maybe 50, I don't know. I'm not good at measurements. I'm not good at a lot of things. My arms are stretched out along the dull gray railing that's pressing against my back. My arms are resting on it, not clinging, casually crucified. The four tubular rungs of the railing run horizontally behind me, like a fence that's keeping me outside the land of those who live happily ever after. I don't belong in that place, and I never will. The top two rungs curve a little, shifting my center of gravity. I'm leaning back from the drop toward the mostly empty road on the bridge that I half crossed to get here. The inward curve was probably meant to stop people from climbing the railing to begin with. I scaled the rungs easily enough, straddled the top, swung my legs over, and climbed back down the other side. This isn't my first time here. I'm calm and tense. My muscles are soft, but my thoughts are tight. I've learned the hard way not to let my body betray my mind's secrets. My fingers are cold and numb, holding me lightly. The railing is wet. It's been a misty Sunday, mid-March, not uncommon on this island. I'm cornered by dirty melting snow all around me, the last of a stubborn winter, splashed into the gutters beside the narrow sidewalk that stretches along the side of the bridge. I think about how much I miss the summer. This place has been part of the plan for the last few months. The bridge is part of an overpass that connects the two neighborhoods on either side of the sprawling, shuttered steel plant. There are two worlds beyond my fingertips, to either side of my outstretched arms. In one direction, beyond my right hand, is Whitney Pier. That's where I tried to live most of the time. Beyond my left hand is the rest of Sydney. I have never been anywhere else, and don't know many others who have. Not many people make it out of this place alive. The only way out of the pier, at least for a kid escaping on foot, is the overpass. At this moment, it certainly feels like the only way out for me. I study the ground below. There's a long chain-link fence topped with mangled lines of barbed wire. The fence is coated with layers and years of gray paint, but the rust bleeds through anyway. How far out will I need to jump, I wonder, with my peculiar calm rigidity, so I don't land on the fence? The whole point is to end the pain, not add to it. A century of steelmaking has left the ground useless, worn out, and toxic. It's dirty and dead down there now, I think. This place understands me. It looks as I feel. I let my gaze follow the line of the rusty fence. It cuts through the backyards of a row of duplex company houses that border the plant. The second one is my Nana Ag's. It looks small and insignificant from up here. I probably look small and insignificant from down there. Everything feels small, the whole city. Yet still, I feel smaller. Sydney stands quiet, closed, on the better side of the train tracks that run under the bridge through Nana Ag's backyard to the harbor cranes on the horizon in front of me. Even the bridge itself doesn't really have much purpose these days. The plant has closed and left its waste behind. They'll tear it all down someday, or it will crumble to the ground. The crumbling has been underway for years, for the bridge and me. That's how things go here, fall or be felled. Now I'm stuck. I can't go back. I won't give them the pleasure. I have to tear it all down. A car passes on the road behind me. It sounds distant and foreign. The driver doesn't see me. Nobody sees me under the incandescent yellow glow of the light post to my left. I used it to steady myself when I climbed over the railing. I didn't want to slip and fall. That wasn't part of the plan. This isn't supposed to be an accident. This is my choice, because as far as I can see, I have no other choices. I hear another car pass, the sound of tires on wet asphalt, the familiar double thump, the distinctive sound of wheels passing over the exposed steel section connectors that barely hold the old overpass together. A hollow, rhythmic sound. Thump, thump. For a fleeting moment, it breaks the silence around me. It punctures the noise inside me, then it's gone. The noise inside me returns to fill the void, like little underwater explosions. Thump, thump. I notice each car that doesn't see me. It's amazing all we see, yet fail to notice. Thump, thump. Sure, some people tried to help. Doctors, nurses, parents, priests. Some were nice, some not. Most either in the middle or indifferent. I'd become just another hopeless case, a frequent flyer, a lost soul. Abandon hope, all who enter here. I noticed someone over my shoulder. I didn't hear him arrive. He's been talking to me, trying to help. Too bad I'm helpless. The cops are here now, too. Beyond my fingertips, in both directions. I pull my gaze from the unreachable horizon long enough to see that they've barricaded the bridge, that crowds have started to gather. I know they've come to see me fall. I feel nothing. There's nothing to see here. I'm surrounded by people, yet still I'm alone. There's laughter somewhere. It's all I can hear, even in the silence, laughter, stabbing me in the head. Fall or be felled. Fuck it. I'll tear it all down. I feel my heart in my chest. Thump, thump. My mind is noisy again. There's a lot happening behind me now. I tried, I cry aloud. I tried, I tried, I tried. Thump, thump. I can't. I have no choice. Jump, you coward, someone shouts. Thump, thump. I let go. Part 1. The Summer. Tell me, what else should I have done? Doesn't everything die at last and too soon? Tell me. What is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? Mary Oliver, The Summer Day. Chapter 1. I could see my grandmother's house from where I stood, on the wrong side of the railing. I can't remember the names of all Nana Ag's kids. Then again, neither could she. There were 17 in total, including my mom. Most of those kids had kids of their own, and many of those eventually had kids too. By the time I came along, Nana didn't get too caught up in names. She would rattle off 3 or 4 guesses before saying, "Hey, you." She'd point if she meant you. "Who owns you?" she'd ask. Knowing who our parents were at least narrowed the field. It still makes me smile to remember her forgetting our names, long before she forgot us all for good. The Costigans were a devout Catholic family, Irish, via Newfoundland, so that should explain the large family. Nana Ag raised the first half of them, including Papa Mike's 5 kids from his first wife, in a ramshackle attic apartment above an old movie theater in the pier. After the skylight collapsed, raining shards of glass onto one of my uncles in his crib, they decided it was time to find new lodgings. They moved to a little 3-bedroom duplex on Railroad Street just before my mom was born. It was a closer walk for Papa to get to work at the plant. He'd bought both sides of the duplex sight unseen, but moved his family into only one. He rented out the other side to pay for it. A lot of my memories started on Railroad Street. My father's parents weren't far behind in the post-war mission to repopulate the earth, or at least to populate Sydney. Nana Marg had 16 kids. The Henick family was Austrian, or German, or Romanian, depending on who you ask, with some more Irish in there because that too was the Cape Breton way. Cape Breton has more fiddlers per capita than anywhere else in the world. The Hennicks were nominally Catholic, but nobody would have claimed pious devotion as their excuse for reproducing so extensively. One family story has it that Nana Marg fled to the church down the hill for safety from my shell-shocked and sometimes violent grandfather. She was sent home and told to obey her husband, however many fists or bottles or guns he waved around. That was long before I was born, so I don't remember ever seeing her at Mass or even near a church, for that matter. Nobody in the family ever really talks about any of that. Certain things, in some families, are simply unspeakable. The two big families only occasionally crossed paths in my little hometown, but I was always aware that the two families couldn't have been more different. Conversations with Nana Ag were dotted with attempts to decipher her many Newfoundland idioms. You stay where you to, and I come where you at. Nana Marg, on the other hand, amazed us with ever newer and more creative ways of inserting the word fuck into places where it otherwise didn't belong. Damn goddamn cock-fucking-suckers charging $5 for a pack of smokes. Smokes were currency, and a common cause of conflict. She guarded them closely, fishing them out of her bra as needed. As crude as her kids could be, and they could be, they'd never go for them there. Marg lived up the hill from us, which earned her the name Up Nan, while Agnes lived down the hill, and therefore became Down Nan. We lived somewhere in the middle, between the two houses that seemed like two different worlds, but it was all relative. They reigned over their respective queendoms, one with fury and the other with grace. They were loved and they were needed, each in her own way, by the community of people they'd raised. For all their differences, they shared a place that had seen a lot of change. It was a different time when they were raising their families in Sydney. The city, the whole island, in fact, was booming. People came from everywhere, by boat over the open ocean, and from the seemingly distant mainland by a narrow, then busy causeway. The steel plant and all the industries that grew to support it gave people purpose, meaning, a living wage for an honest day's work. With so many Irish immigrants, heartbreak was a common expectation. Life is hard. That's just the way it is. Everyone here knew that. By the time I was born, much of the town's glory was gone. So too was the booming industry, the work and wages, the honesty. Many families remained, however. Most did. Where else would they go? This was their home. The plant was mostly still standing, at least until the long-drawn-out efforts to find a buyer dried up. When the six big smokestacks that towered over the tar ponds came down with a crash of dynamite, we watched from the chain-link perimeter fence that cut through the backyard of Nana Ag's duplex next door. The explosion echoed as far as the Cold War radar base atop Blueberry Hill, just behind Nana Marg's house. One place that remained constant was Holy Redeemer. It was a 100-year-old red brick church with a tall, square bell tower, easily visible from the big picture windows in our house up on Lingan Road. Nana Ag and Papa Mike had their children baptized there, instilling in them a lifetime devotion, even after Papa stopped going following the Second Vatican Council. "I don't understand," he said, "how men can just change something that God created." Papa Mike married Nana Ag at Holy Redeemer, according to the white-glazed decorative plate that hung permanently above their kitchen table. They had a lot of little things like that hanging around the house. We mostly weren't the chapter-and-verse type of Catholics. Still, many in the family could recite the familiar verses, probably thanks to Nana Ag's walls. It was common to find passages inscribed on a piece of wood or porcelain throughout her house and mounted in the homes of all the Costigans. The Sermon on the Mount was popular. The Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are they who mourn, blessed are the peacemakers, etc., and the parable of the wise and foolish builders, who built their houses on rock and sand, respectively.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.